Hey, Paulie, where you been hiding lately?
Oh, man, you haven't seen me in a while, have you?
It's been a while.
Well, I auditioned for a movie, so I had to grow this beard.
Santa Claus?
It's about Rip Van Winkle, who is an old blacksmith, and he wakes up and has a new welding machine. He can't believe all the high technology. So what's going on in the shop today?
We got a customer who needs a repair on an old rusty thing, antique thing, and I don't think Art Weld is going to get it.
Have you ever tried Oxy-Fuel brazing?
I haven't done much of that.
Never had a need for it, huh?
Never had a need for
it. Well, man, it's great stuff, especially on materials you don't know what they are.
Right.
Materials that are odd, like zinc, stainless to copper, regular steel, brass. And it's a really strong process, too. I saw a demo one time where they took some chrome moly steel and brazed it together with low-fuming bronze rod. And then they put it on a tensile tester where they pull the parts apart.
Right.
And the chrome moly had a tensile strength of 80,000 PSI tensile strength. And the metal broke before the weld did.
It's a pretty strong weld, isn't it?
Oh, it's very strong. So a lot of people think, oh, that's just a braze weld. They are extremely strong. They're usually stronger than the base material. So
that's good information.
Yeah. I mean, the big difference is you're not melting the base material, which is why it's so good for fixing antiques and stuff like that. You're actually just heating the base up and then putting this bronze on it, low fuming bronze. Mm. And it actually sticks to it like a super duper glue. It's a bronze glue.
Right.
And that makes it a lot easier to use, and it does less damage to the part. And instead of melting the thing and possibly destroying it, you're just basically putting this glue on there. And you can always melt the bronze off if you don't like what it looks like, or if you put it in the wrong position. So I think that's really what you need to use today.
So good. So what do we need to do this brazing thing with?
Well, you got a cutting torch, don't you? And some regulators and oxyacetylene. That's all you need. You need a welding tip, though, that you can use for either the bronze brazing, or you can actually weld with that tip. And I see you got one of those. So, we're ready to go.
Let's get started.
Here, I thought I'd have to bring in my mom's old torch today. This is old Harris from 1942. She worked out in the aircraft business building airplanes in Long Beach. Look at that thing.
That thing is old. Nice antique torch.
Oh, look. What do you got over there?
Well, this is the new Harris. You know, this is the new and improved.
Well, we'll use that one today.
Yeah, we'll do something with it.
Okay. We got our oxygen. We want to clear any dust that might have gotten in here because the cap has a hole. So you just kind of crack it and blow anything out that's in there. Our acetylene, since it's a flammable gas, we don't really want to open it up like that. We just want to take a clean rag, kind of wipe around in there. Look at all that dirt come out of there. You don't want any dirt getting in your regulators. So first things first, we're going to set our oxygen regulator on. These threads are right-hand threads, unlike the acetylene, which is a left-hand thread. So always remember that in case you can't unscrew one, that it's not righty-tighty, lefty-loosey. Also, the fittings are completely different, so it's impossible to put them on wrong. You never want to put any oil on your regulators, on the gauges, on the threads, nothing. Any oil or lubricants with high-pressure oxygen can cause a major explosion. They don't have to be vertical, they can be tilted. And a lot of times I'll tilt mine so they're easier for me to see if they're down real low. Okay, a lot of times you'll see a wrench like this, it's the handy dandy all purpose. The problem with this wrench is it's so thin, it'll tear up these brass fittings. So you wanna keep from using one of these except in an emergency. No vice grips, no pliers. If you have a dedicated wrench the right size, it's 1 1/8. But the problem is with that, you may need to do this, which is a 5/8. So I'm using this both the right hand and left hand adjustable. It's also metric and imperial threads. Just snug it down. You don't have to twist it off because it is a brass fitting and you don't want to tear it up. Now here's one of the most important things. When you go to open your oxygen, you don't want to slam it open because the heat of the high pressure oxygen coming out can literally blow this regulator apart. You never want to stand in front of it. You never want to stand in back of it. You just want to slowly crack it and then open it completely, because there's two valves in here. There's a shutoff valve and then there's a completely open valve. And if you don't go all the way to the top, you're going to be leaking oxygen out. On the acetylene, we want to crack it too, but we only want to turn it about a half. That way, if something happens and we got to turn the fuel off is what's going to be burning, we can shut it off really quick, just like that. Now, you might have noticed that these gauges are showing the pressure that's in the cylinder. This is the high pressure side. This side is the working pressure. It has nothing on it. It's controlled by this diaphragm. This diaphragm always needs to be backed off when you're not using the regulator. A lot of people say, oh, don't mess with that because you messed up my settings. Well, if you have a certain setting you like, just get a grease pencil and write it right on here so you'll know what to go back to. But by leaving that in, you're going to ruin the spring in there and the diaphragm. So I'm going to turn this up to 5 because that's what the manufacturer says on their information for the size tip we have. Okay, so that's at 5 PSI right there. Same thing with the acetylene. It's showing the pressure in the cylinder. And we're set on 5 right there. We're ready to go. When you're done, you want to shut these off. I'm going to show you real quick the proper way of turning them off. Shut them all the way down. Leave the diaphragm in. Purge your hose. See that go down? See that go down? So we're purging it. Okay? Nothing left in there. Now we back this off completely and you're good to go. When you go to lunch, do this. When you at the end of the day, do this. If you're going to walk away from the torches for 15 minutes, shut it down. Yeah, you waste a little gas, but you also make the system safe. We're going to use this striker to light our torch. Don't use matches, a lighter, cigarette lighter. You'll burn your hands. Ask me how I know. Put a little bit of acetylene in, light it. Notice this smoke coming off of here. You want to add more acetylene until that smoke goes away, like that. And then you can turn in the oxygen. Now this is what's called a reducing or carburizing flame. That's not what we want. It's got an excess of acetylene in it. We want to add more oxygen until it looks like this. If we add too much oxygen, we get an oxidizing flame, which looks like that, and that tends to burn the metal. It's very similar to what a cutting torch does. When you get ready to turn it off, you want to turn the acetylene off, all the flames go away, and then shut the oxygen off. Okay, we've got our mill scale cleaned off of our metal. That's super important. Got some round bar that we've cleaned up. If you don't take the mill scale off, the bronze won't stick to the metal. It'll just float on top of it and you can tap it off with a hammer. What we're going to use is low fuming bronze. This particular rod has a coating on it. They make bare coated rods. And sometimes if you have old rods like this, the coating may disappear. So what do? You get some of this flux right here, which is basically borax. It's kind of hard to get though, because people don't use it as much as they used to, and everybody likes these pre-coated ones. But if you get in a jam and can't find this at your local welding supply place, just go get some 20 Mule Team borax at the grocery store and that works fine. Well, back to the rod. What is low fuming bronze? It's 58% copper, 40% zinc, 1% tin, and the last 1% is manganese, iron, and silicon. The silicon acts as a deoxidizer. So enough of that science stuff. Let's talk about safety. Obviously, we're dealing with heat. We need to protect our hands. We also need to protect our eyes. There's a couple different ways of doing it. There's special glasses that are made for this. These are a shade 3. They also make a shade 5. I have a shade 5 in this big hood, which is great because I wear glasses and I can't really use these with the glasses without it being difficult. You can also use your auto darkening hood and put it on the grind mode. That's a shade 3. You'll be able to see well with that. And you've got another type of auto darkening like this, which you can flip up and see everything bright. I think I'm going to start out with just the shade 5. See how well I can see on that. I do have these groovy goggles here, and they fit over my glasses, so I'll use those too. Let's start out with the goggles. What the heck? You want to bring the base metal up to a red hot, bright red. You don't want it to be yellow, and you don't want it to be white. Those are way too hot, and if you get that hot, pull the torch away and let it cool down slightly. Once it's red hot, you're ready to start brazing. On the other hand, if it's a dull red or less than that, it's not hot enough to accept the bronze. So you need to get it to that bright red to properly braze. After you've gotten your base metal to red hot, then you can start adding filler. What will happen first is the flux will start melting and go to the base, and then the filler starts melting. Now what you can do is just put it in the flame, and it'll wet right out onto where you have your flux and just move along. You can raise the torch up and down to vary your heat. You can do little circles with the torch. It's all up to you and what you're comfortable with.
Okay, you'll notice that the bronze is really a thin little layer here. And what happens is, due to capillary action, that's where the molten metal actually gets drawn into the joint without any outside force like gravity or anything. And because of that, it has a lot larger area of contact. And that's really important on one of these adhesive welds. So we're going to test this thing and break it and just see just how strong it is. You can see the wicking action in here where it's gone all the way through and held it. This area here did not have the mill scale taken off, so it's probably why it didn't go real far. And also there was no flux on there. If I had to put some molten flux down, or that powdered flux, it would have definitely come closer. But I had a heck of a time pulling that up. Yes, it broke, but it would have broken if it was steel too. It doesn't take much rod at all to do this. One of the nice things about brazing is, even though it may be different than the steel and have a gold color, it can be decorative too. So if you feel like doing some arty stuff. If you're trying to do a repair, though, and not have it seen, well, that's a different animal. Well, that looks pretty darn nice. Okay, well, this is our piece that we bent, and it broke. But if you look at how chewed up that metal is for us to get it to bend and break. Now, I've run a wire brush across here, and it's nice and clean. If you look at this little piece right here, you can see some scaling, or basically, it's the flux that's left on there. It's kind of a glass-like stuff. That'll come off with a wire brush and a little water. You want to get that off if you're putting a clear coat or paint on, because after a few days, because it's just glass laying up there, it'll actually pop off. Let me run the wire brush on it a little bit. And you can see how small that is. You know, where the bronze has gone inside there. But if you look on the back, you can see how it's penetrated through with that capillary or wicking action. So it's got a lot of area that it's touched there. Now, it didn't make it all the way through here because we were moving a little faster up on that end. So I hope that shows just what brazing can do. I'm not even going to try to break this one because I doubt if I can. And I'd need a really big hammer to do it.
So, Paulie, looks like you like this brazing thing, and looks like it's going to work on a repair that I'm going to have to make.
You know, I've repaired a lot of stuff that
you know, no one else could repair. And it's a simple process. So, you know, you got the hang of it now. You know what to do.
That's great. Hope you guys like this video. Be sure to connect with us directly at Weld.com and download our app, Weld. You'll make valuable industry connections. Check out our e-learning with educational curriculum developed by professionals. Showcase your work and business and much more. See you on the next one.